International Education. Bueno, somos muy orgullosos para tener esta noche a University of New South Wales y Thomas Kappa para presentar la universidad, los cursos de todo, con, especialmente pensando en las becas, a don Carlos Antonio López. Para explicar nuestro papel un poco en eso, LA Education, somos el representante de UNSW. En realidad, somos el representante de todas las universidades de Australia y de Nueva Zelanda. Entonces, vamos a ofrecer muchos de los cursos. Trabajamos directamente con las universidades. Entonces, nuestro papel en eso es que asesorar a los estudiantes para asistir a ellos para tomar mejores decisiones en sus cursos. También para hacer las aplicaciones, hacer la visa, etc. También estamos aquí para cualquier duda que tienen, puede ser también qué tipo de vida es en Australia, estamos ahí para eso. Pero University of New South Wales es uno de los mejores en el mundo, uno de los mejores en Australia. Es uno de los Group of Eight, que se decía que es una de las mejores 8 universidades en Australia. Y en realidad también es uno en rankings, uno de los mejores en 1% de todas las universidades del mundo. Y bueno, y esta noche tenemos Thomas Kappa, que es representante de UNSW, para charlar un poco con ustedes. Él va a hacer presentación en la universidad y cualquier pregunta que ustedes tienen, tienen espacio ahí para escribir la pregunta y después de la presentación vamos a ver las preguntas uno por uno. Entonces, por ahora voy a dejar a ustedes en la mano de Thomas y entonces, Thomas, it's all yours.
Thank you. Okay, well, thank you very much, David, for introducing myself and also the university. Tonight I'm just going to go through some key points about the university that I think are important to international students. I'm going to talk a lot about support services that the university offers, and I will also touch on our rankings, which are going to be important when you apply for your scholarships. So UNSW is globally recognized for innovative teaching, world-leading research, and our state-of-the-art facilities. Our university attracts over 52,000 students, including 14,000 international students from over 120 countries. In the last round of scholarships from Paraguay, we were actually lucky enough to receive 2 students, one of which is studying a Master of Engineering Science, and the other is studying a Master of Design. Sorry, just give me one moment. Okay. So as I said, we have modern facilities and innovative teaching spaces. We also have a fantastic location that not many universities can boast about. UNSW Australia is located in Sydney's eastern suburbs. It's about 20 minutes by bus to the city centre, so that's where we have the famous Opera House and Harbour Bridge. And we're also close to some of Sydney's most popular beaches and parks. The closest beach is about 5 minutes by bus, and if you look at that photo that's right in front of you now, you can see the ocean in the background. So 5 minutes by bus is Coogee Beach. It's about 2 kilometres, so within walking distance. And Bondi Beach, about 40 minutes away by bus. We have public transport links in all directions across Sydney. We don't have a train station, unlike some universities, but that shouldn't concern you, as the public transport in Australia is very good indeed. We're also 20 minutes away from the international airport, so when you fly in, you'll land, you can catch a taxi, and within 20 minutes you'll be at the university, at our Student Development International office, where you'll be able to get information about the university, about Sydney in general, and the next steps that you should take. I'm going to show a short video. It's about 1.5 minutes, and it's going to focus on UNSW engineering. We have the largest engineering faculty in Australia, and that will be shown here in the video, and I'll come back in just one second. Apologies, here we go. Okay, hopefully you could hear that. I realized as I was playing the video that perhaps you couldn't, so hopefully you could, and if not, I turned on the subtitles, so hopefully you'll be able to read those. So there's a number of things that the university is proud of, and I'm just going to touch on a few of those. It has a very long history, so we were actually founded in 1949, so there have been lots of discoveries that have happened. There's lots of fantastic lecturers and staff who have come through the university as well. In terms of rankings, the overall ranking of the university is 46th in the world in terms of the QS World University Rankings. We're also recognized for our global connections, scoring 83.5% for our international outlook. So as I said before, we have about 14,000 international students from 120 different countries, and that represents around 25% of our entire student population. So you will be attending class with students from all over the world. It's an extremely multicultural university. We're still one of only 11 universities in the world to hold the five-star QS 5-star plus rating. We're ranked within the top 100 according to the US News and World Report rankings, and 22nd in the world for employer reputation. This one here is important because obviously when you study at UNSW, once you finish your studies, something that you will put on your CV or your curriculum is the university's name. And so this number, 22nd in the world for employer reputation, just proves how strong the UNSW brand is. So when you return back to Paraguay, if you're looking for jobs with multinational companies, for example, if you have a look on LinkedIn, you'll find that there are a number of students that are probably already working there. Obviously, perhaps not in Paraguay, but in different locations around the world. I don't want to get caught up on this too much. These are the university rankings. This is a summary. Sometimes government sponsors will focus a lot on the rankings in their decision to award scholarships or not. So it's important that I touch on these, but I do ask that you really have a look at the content of your master's program, whether that be master's by research or master's by coursework or a doctorate. It's very important that you choose the correct program for you based on the courses that are offered. In terms of the Times Higher Education rankings, our overall ranking was 82nd. In the disciplinary rankings, social science, we ranked within the top 50. Preclinical and clinical health, we were ranked 54th. Engineering and technology, we were ranked 63rd. Arts and humanities, we were ranked 100. The QS World University Rankings, which we tend to do a little bit better in, and they're just two different styles of rankings, so one is not better than the other, I don't think. The QS World University Rankings, we were overall 46th in the world, so that's a fantastic result for us. Our faculty areas were extremely strong in engineering and technology, as you saw in the video. Social sciences and management as well, we ranked 21st in the world. Arts and humanities, 41st. Natural sciences, we're ranked 61st in the world. When we talk about subjects that are ranked in the top 50, I don't really want to go through all of these, but I will point out a few. These are all ranked within the top 50 in the world. Okay, so we're very strong in what is civil and structural engineering, material sciences, chemical process engineering, computer science and information systems, also environmental studies. So we have a fantastic Master of Environmental Management, which is very popular with a lot of our Latin students, or students from South America, sorry. Education is another big one for us, so we're ranked 41st in terms of subjects. Medicine, English language and literature, communications and media studies. I also would like to point out architecture there too. Shanghai Jiao Tong is the third measure or ranking system, and there you'll see our overall ranking is slightly above the 100 mark, but engineering, technology and computer sciences, again, very strong, mathematics as well. So now I've spoken a little bit about our areas of strength in terms of rankings. I'll talk about Sydney because obviously that is a huge draw card for lots of international students. Sydney is a fantastic city to live in, very multicultural, and as you can see in that picture, the sun's always shining. Sydney is Australia's financial hub, so we're home to more global firms than any other Australian city, such as Google, Samsung, Nestle, Bank of America, etc. We have some of Australia's best living standards, and we were ranked amongst the top 10 best cities to live in the world in the Mercer 2015 Quality of Living Standards Survey. We're also consistently voted one of the most popular cities in the world for international students. And so we're consistently beating more than 83 cities, such as London, Paris, and New York. I touched on this a little bit before. When you finish your studies at UNSW and you go on to work at major corporations, you'll find that there are alumni also working in those top companies too. You form part of a global network of alumni students coming from all over the world. So we currently have around 250,000 alumni living in over 140 different countries and working for some of the world's biggest companies. We also are a member of a number of different global network of university partners. We have over 500 different partnerships with universities, organizations, and industry leaders all over the world. Hopefully I'm not speaking too fast for all of you and you're understanding me. Please take down some questions, and at the end I'd really love to hear from you. So one of the groups that we are a member of is the Group of Eight, which are the top eight universities that are research intensive in Australia. So we do have a very strong focus on what is research. So UNSW is recognised as a leading university in the Excellence in Research in Australia report, and we're known internationally for pioneering research in the area of photovoltaics, solar energy, quantum computing, interactive cinema, HIV, AIDS research, and also in cancer research. In 2013, our research income was over 347 million Australian dollars, which is extremely high. We have some of the highest citations per paper of all Australian university across 26 different areas. We also have produced more technology and entrepreneurs in the past 15 years than any other Australian university. And then another very interesting point is our Easy Access IP. So New South Innovations, which sits within the university, launched Easy Access IP, which offers most of our intellectual property to companies for free. And then just in the bottom right-hand corner there, you can see some of our research strengths. So ICT, robotics and devices, biomedical sciences. We have a fantastic Master of Biomedical Engineering. Next generation materials and technology, water, environment and sustainability, social policy, government and health policy, business, law and economics. Our law faculty is actually ranked 13th in the world in the most recent QS rankings. We have an ingrained culture of innovation. This building that you see here is recently completed towards the end of 2015. And this is just an architectural drawing, but it's the Michael Crouch Innovation Center. And it boasts a huge 1,000 meter fit out with state-of-the-art facilities, including an innovation hall, multifunctional workspace, 3D printers, and laser cutters. The Michael Crouch Innovation Center has a number of opportunities for students to make appointments and speak with business development managers. So you may be an engineer with a fantastic idea. You may be a scientist and you think that you have discovered something extraordinary and you want to try and take that idea to market. And so the Michael Crouch Innovation Center can be a one-stop shop for that, where you can get help on how to do that, how to take that idea to market and find out whether it is an idea that will potentially make money. UNSW scientists are also leading the world in creating the bionic eye, and we believe that in making the bionic eye a reality in the not-so-distant future. UNSW's SunSwift solar car, which was mentioned in the video I showed you, has lived up to its names, and we've smashed the Guinness World Record to become the world's fastest solar vehicle. and the car itself is designed and built by UNSW students. We also boast more leading CEOs of the Australian Stock Exchange top 100 companies than any other university in Australia. We have a careers and employment department on campus, and they arrange 4 expos throughout the year. So although as you're on a scholarship you're unable to work during your time in Australia, if you do receive that scholarship, I should say, they do have 4 different expos that they arrange. So they have their career expo, which is a chance for students to meet and discuss potential employment opportunities with more than 100 participating high-profile companies. Again, if you do receive the scholarship from the Paraguayan government, you cannot work, but you may be able to make some links with important companies that are also have offices in Paraguay. There's also the UNSW Volunteer Work Expo, so this could be a great way for you to connect with non-profit organizations that are offering volunteering positions. That would be something fantastic that you could put on your curriculum. We have an internship expo as well, and we run a number of different professional development programs throughout the semester that international students can take advantage of. At UNSW, we realize that our international students are very far away from home, so you often don't have your support networks with you, you don't have friends and family around, and offering services for supporting our international students is extremely important to make sure that you can focus on your academic studies and do the best in that area and fall back on these services should you need to. Some of the support services that we offer, we have language and conversation skills classes that are free of charge. So these aren't formal English classes, but they are ways for you to practice your conversation skills with local domestic students or Australian students or even international students too. We provide housing assistance. We have a housing office on campus. Health and well-being. We actually have a doctor's surgery, an optometry clinic, a pharmacy on campus as well. And as an international student, you must obtain what we call overseas student health cover. When you purchase your overseas student health cover, if you do need to see the doctor when you are in Australia, if you attend the doctor's surgery on campus, all you need to do is show them your card, and there is no additional cost that you need to pay to see the doctor. Obviously, if you need to buy antibiotics or medicine or anything like that, you do need to purchase that separately. Safety on campus. We are a public university, so we don't have gates or fences around our university. Anybody can walk into campus and enjoy not the facilities, but you know, can go to the restaurants on campus, can see the doctor on campus, etc. So we do take safety seriously, and we have 24-hour security. We also have specific areas throughout the campus that are lit up 24 hours a day, and a number of emergency help points. So if you do feel at any point, at any time threatened, you can approach one of these emergency points and make a phone call, and security will come out and see you. We have cultural mentor programs. As I mentioned before, the professional development program is a great opportunity for international students. On arrival support, clubs and societies. This is very important too. Although you're at UNSW to study, we have over 180, I believe, clubs and society, and these range from anything like the maths club, the outdoor club, the surfing club, and it's a fantastic way for you to make friends outside of your academic circle. So although you may be studying engineering, you can meet people who, let's say, like to play chess and are part of the chess club, and who are studying maths or science, for example. There's a number of career development opportunities within our careers and employment department, so they can talk to you about interviewing techniques, how to create a fantastic curriculum, for example, and there's a number of social activities that are also available. So lots of people like to play sports, but perhaps they're not at a professional level, so we have social sports, but we also have competitive sports that you can join competitive sports teams. Hopefully I'm not going too fast for everyone. So we like to say that we're a campus that never sleeps. As I said, we do have areas that are lit up, such as the main walk, which you can see in this photo here, just to make sure that students feel safe and secure when they're walking around late at night. You may find that you have class during the day, but it's not out of the norm for you to have class at nighttime as well. So we're a modern campus. The campus is said to be worth around $1.2 billion. We're always buzzing with students and activity, whether it's in the early morning or late in the day. As I said, we have around 52,000 students from over 120 different countries. There are a number of support services. We have ARC, Health Services, UNSW Sport and Recreation. So we have a gym on campus as well and a swimming pool. So in the gym, they offer all sorts of programs that you can do, taekwondo, there's squash courts, badminton courts, basketball courts, indoor soccer facilities. This is at an additional cost if you would like to join the gym, but it is at a student rate. We have two banks on campus at the moment. So if you open up a bank account, for example, with the Commonwealth Bank, you can actually go and do all of your banking in between your classes. Well, before I actually developed this presentation, I did have a chat with our two Paraguayan students, and one of the things that they suggested was that you do set up a bank account before you leave Paraguay. And it's definitely possible, and that's something you should think about doing. That way, when you arrive, everything is set up and ready to go. We have food courts and cafes, so we have lots of different restaurants on campus. Lots of different cafes where you can meet your friends, where you can sit around and you can do your assignments, for example. We have wireless internet access on campus, and that's free for all students. So at any point on the campus, you can access the internet. We have a library, which is, I believe, around 12 stories tall, and we have a number of different facilities in there that you can take advantage of, such as computers, printing, you're able to scan documents. We have rooms that you can meet with fellow classmates in to prepare presentations, and that's a fantastic place to go to as well during the day in between classes or even at night when you're studying for your final exams. So the campus should feel like it's a home away from home, and we have over 4,000 beds on campus, so we have a variety of different accommodation styles that students can choose from. This photo that you can see here is an example of our colleges. So if you did select to live in the colleges, you would have your own room. You may have an ensuite, being a bathroom, or you may share a bathroom with those that are on your same floor. The college setup also has 21 meals a week, so that's 3 meals a day, 7 days a week, and that is included in your cost. The fees, obviously, that are included are water, electricity, gas, the food, for example, in this case. Internet is another one. Other options are studio apartments, one-bedroom apartments, five-bedroom apartments that obviously have their own kitchens. So food is not provided, and in that instance, you would have to do your own cooking. But that, again, can be a great way to make friends, too. I would probably say that most of our postgraduate students choose the apartment style rather than the colleges, although we do have colleges that are specifically for postgraduate students or may have floors within the college that are for postgraduate students. There's a mix of international and local students that live within our on-campus accommodation. We have lots of students from rural areas of Australia or that may be from Brisbane, for example, or Melbourne, Tasmania, Victoria, etc., and that come to UNSW to study. So they obviously can live on campus as well. So the living on campus allows you to be in a convenient location. You obviously don't have to spend money on public transport to get to and from the university. You can roll out of bed and pretty much go to class. It's a safe and secure environment, and it really is a community lifestyle. So you will meet lots of students. You will spend lots of time on campus as well. Aside from living on campus, you can also opt to find off-campus accommodation, private housing, for example, although keep in mind there are quite high setup costs. If you decide to rent an apartment, you will have to sign a contract probably for a minimum of 6 months to a year. You would then need to potentially buy a bed, a microwave, a fridge, etc. So these are all high costs to set up. There are a number of different accommodation options also off campus that may be a house or an apartment where students are already living, and they may be renting out a room that already has all of the facilities that you need, such as a bed, a desk, etc. The majority of students will look for those online, although once you have applied to the university and you have a UNSW student ID, which you would get at the time of receiving an offer letter, you can access a portal that has some accommodation options linked there. So the learning experience, this is another thing that I wanted to touch on and something that our two Paraguayan students mentioned to me that I should talk about. They said that the teaching style is quite different from what they were used to in Paraguay. Learning at UNSW and most Australian institutions is quite independent, and there's fewer contact hours as well. Typically you'll have lectures which can be large, so you may have between 30 and 300 students in some of your lectures. And in this instance, students mainly listen and take notes to a professor who's talking at them and going through a PowerPoint presentation just as I am now. And they're also often recorded. So if, for example, you know, you're in your first week and you're getting accustomed to the Australian accent, for example, you can access the lectures by going to the library, for example, or also online as well. And you can listen to those as many times as you want until you understand the content. Apart from lectures, you'll also have tutorials, and these are smaller groups, so probably a maximum of around 20 students per class. Attendance is compulsory in the tutorials and also for many of the lectures. And this is a great opportunity for you to ask questions and discuss lecture topics. So you should come very well prepared to these tutorials. You should have done your readings beforehand, have questions prepared, like hopefully you do at the end of my presentation. Depending on your area of study, you might also have laboratories and seminars, and again, these are smaller groups, so up to around 20 per class, and these are technical and hands-on courses, typically within engineering, science, medical science. Again, attendance is compulsory. Assessment details in course can be found in course outlines, which you receive at the beginning of each semester. So the course outline will tell you exactly what it is that you will be studying each week. It will tell you the compulsory assessment tasks. So you may have a quiz halfway through the semester, a final exam, a number of different papers or assessments that you need to write during the semester, and group presentations, for example. So I'm coming to the end of my presentation. I haven't quite gone the full 40 minutes, David. I'm sorry about that. Coming up to about half an hour, I think. These are just some photos here of the campus of Sydney itself as a city. Obviously, it looks like it's sunny all the time, but I can assure you that it's not sunny everywhere all the time. There is rain. Typically, though, the climate in Sydney is not too harsh. You'll find that during winter, probably doesn't get below around 15 degrees Celsius. During summer, it can get upwards of about 35 degrees Celsius, and as we're very close to the beach, after your academic studies are over, you can, you know, go down there and go for a swim and hang out. So it's a fantastic location. It's a fantastic university. I really do recommend that you consider it. I guess the very last thing that I did want to talk about were just eight master's programs that we offer that typically we see a lot of students from South America applying for. So we have a Master of Engineering Science, which is a two-year program. Depending on your academic background, you may be eligible for recognized prior learning, and that means that your program could be shortened to 1 year in duration. And that's all decided upon application when your application is assessed by our admissions office. We offer over 25 different specializations within this master's program, ranging from biomedical engineering, chemical process engineering, all of your standard electrical, civil, environmental, manufacturing engineering, mechanical engineering. Some other ones that are quite interesting include petroleum engineering, mining engineering, water resources, catchments and coasts, water, wastewater and waste engineering, and also energy systems is another fantastic one. We have a Master of Sustainable Built Environment, which can be a great option for students who have completed already a Bachelor of Architecture. We have a Master of Public Relations and Advertising taught by our Faculty of Arts and Social Science, which is one of the largest faculties of its kind in Australia. A Master of Design, which is taught at our Paddington campus. So we do actually have three campuses. We have our, I guess you'd call it main campus, which is the Kensington campus, which I showed you in the second slide, which the majority of our courses are, programs are taught at both undergraduate and postgraduate level. The Master of Design, the Master of Arts, is taught at our Paddington campus, which is about 10 minutes away, heading in the direction of the city. We have a Master of Materials Technology, a Master of Education, Master of Environmental Management, which I briefly mentioned before, and also a Master of Information Technology. So these are only 8 of our 900 programs that we offer. The very last slide, you'll have my contact details, but I encourage you to have a look online at the UNSW website to contact Latino Australia Education, and you're also more than welcome to contact me if you have any specific questions about programs or general questions. I'm happy to answer those for you. So thank you very much for your time. Hopefully you've learned a little bit about UNSW. Maybe I've convinced you to apply to the university, and at the bottom there you'll see my name, my email, and also the general email for Latino Australia Education. I think that's about it from me. David, if you're still there and want to manage the question and answer session, I'm ready when you are.
Okay, yeah, Thomas, yes, I am still here. No, muchísimas gracias, muy informativo todo. Realmente una opción excelente, tienen gama muy amplio para las becas. También los rankings están importantes para becal y University of New South Wales está muy bien en todo aspectos en los rankings general y también los rankings sobre cada área de estudios. Sí, tenemos algunas preguntas aquí. Una de Lía, ¿ahora tienen un rango de edad mínimo y máximo para las becas? Thomas, this is just something about the becas, the scholarship, so I'll answer that one. Lía, para tener una beca tiene que tener mínimo de un grado hecho, so no hay una edad mínimo, pero hay es como mínimo que necesita el grado terminado. Máximo, 35 para una maestría y 40 para doctorado. Segunda pregunta, el programa podría ser por un año y podría estar enfocado en emprender el idioma. Las becas están para maestrías y doctorados. Si está falta un poco del idioma, de inglés, sí hay becas para hacerlo, becas limitadas, algo como 10 semanas, entonces la gente que está en falta un poco de inglés, sí para tener el inglés pagado antes de arrancar el curso. La tercera pregunta, en el caso de estudiar por un año inglés en la universidad, el alumno de intercambio vivirá en el campus universitario o con una familia designada. Lía, para tomar la decisión vos, so, entonces está ahí homestay, que puede quedar ahí, o también para hacer departamentos o las cosas que ha hablado Thomas. Otra pregunta de César, estoy interesado en ir a estudiar en la universidad por un año, dándole a mi estudio en enfoque en el aprendizaje del idioma. Me encantaría hacer una experiencia completa, como incluir deportes como el fútbol, un trabajo de medio tiempo y tener también los tiempos libres. ¿Es conversable esta posibilidad? Sí, yo para decir que en las becas no están para inglés, son para maestrías y para doctorados. Yo creo que explicar la parte del idioma, pero las universidades normalmente tienen cientos de clubes, o club de fútbol, fútbol soccer, o club de fútbol australiano, o club de fútbol rugby, todo eso es posible. Bueno, de Rocio, ¿cuáles serían los requisitos y la financiación de la beca? Rocio, sorry, Thomas, these are all about the scholarship, so I'll just
That's
answer
okay.
these quickly.
No problem.
Los requisitos puede ver, tiene requisitos de grado, tiene requisitos de edad, tiene requisitos en área de estudios. Por ejemplo, las prioridades son en ciencias de tecnología, turismo, educación, etc. Y la financiación de la beca, si ustedes tienen el éxito para tener beca, pagan casi todo, pagan la matrícula, pagan $1,556 americanos por mes para vivir, pagan el vuelo, pagan $500 solamente para llegar, pagan parte de la visa, pagan algunas otras cosas así, entonces realmente puede ser casi sin nada del bolsillo. Para más información hay un buen sitio web que es www.becal.gov.py. Bueno,
David,
otro...
just to add something to that, la universidad también cuenta con becas para estudiantes internacionales. Hay pocas becas, eso sí, y la mayoría están enfocadas en lo que es la investigación. Entonces, un magíster en investigación o un doctorado.
Okay, sí. No, exactamente. Hay becas del gobierno de Paraguay que, bueno, son las más accesibles, pero también hay becas del gobierno de Australia y puede ser que la University of New South Wales tiene algunas becas también. Buenas noches. Mi nombre es Rocio Fleitas y estoy muy interesado en obtener una beca de estudio para ir a Australia, que debería presentar para poder aplicar una beca. Tomas de nuevo yo para contestar eso. Tiene que aplicar en universidad. So, la primera cosa es para elegir el curso que quieras hacer. Después aplicarlo y si la aplicación es exitoso, van a recibir un Certificate of Enrollment, okay, para decir que esté aceptado a la universidad. Con este papel, que puede ser condicional por inglés, o puede ser completo, que tiene el inglés bien, tú puedes ir a la beca para pedir la beca. Otra cosa, antes de arrancar la universidad, necesita completar el examen de inglés, que puede ser TOEFL o puede ser IELTS. Okay? Mateo, can you talk about your courses about law, please, since it struck my attention that was second in your list? Thomas?
Sure. So we offer a Master of Laws. Now the Master of Laws, obviously you do have to come from a law background. So this Master of Laws has a number of specialities, if you want to call it that, or specializations. The program itself, the Master of Laws, is 1 year in duration, and you can begin your studies in February or July. Probably important just to go back to mention that the majority of our programs you can begin in first semester, which begins in February, or second semester, which begins in late July. So the Master of Laws, the specializations that we offer within this program are corporate and commercial law, corporate commercial law and taxation, criminal justice and criminology, dispute resolution, environmental law, human rights and social justice, innovation law, which is something that is very new, international business and economic law, international law, media and technology law, and taxation. Now, what is important to note about this program is that you must have completed a Bachelor of Laws or a Juris Doctor. You also must have a credit average. So a credit average for us is 65%. Now, unfortunately, let's say the grading scale is out of 10, you can't just say it's 6.5. It is scaled a little bit differently. So if you do have questions specific to that, perhaps you could send me an email and I can discuss that further with you in terms of your eligibility for that program.
Okay, question from Diego. Do you offer 1 year masters in marketing or business?
We have a Master of Commerce, which is 1.5 years. We do also have a Masters of Marketing, and I believe it is, let me just have a quick look, excuse me here, the Master of Marketing is 1.5 years as well. So both of those programs you can begin in February or July again, but the minimum time it will take you to finish those is 1.5 years. Actually, I stand corrected. The Master of Commerce, you can apply for recognized prior learning, and in that case, that program could potentially be 1 year duration, as you would get credit for some of the courses that you have studied in your undergraduate degree. Again, you would need to submit your application for us to assess that, and you can then specialize in a number of different areas. It does not have to be marketing. It could be international business. It could be human resource management. There's a number of different opportunities for you there.
Okay, question from Tanya. Good night. Could you give the requirements of English, IELTS or TOEFL, and academics to be accepted?
Sure. So the majority of our programs, if you are submitting an IELTS score, you need to have a 6.5 overall with a minimum of 6.0 in each of the subtests. So that's reading, writing, listening, and speaking. If you decide that you'd like to take the TOEFL, the IBT, the minimum requirement would be a 90 overall with 23 in writing and 22 in reading, listening and speaking. One thing that I would say in terms of English language requirements, although UNSW's language requirements are slightly higher than some other universities, you can be assured that if you do achieve these scores when you arrive in Australia and begin your studies, you will be well prepared, because the last thing we want you to do is to arrive with a less than acceptable English language score and struggle, especially because you'll also be on a scholarship and you can't afford to fail any of your courses.
Okay, a question from Christian. El deadline para las aplicaciones de la beca es el 31 de mayo. Si aplico ahora para el UNSW, ¿puedo recibir mi admission letter antes de esa fecha? Did you understand that, Thomas?
Yeah. Generalmente, podría decir que se demoran entre 4 y 6 semanas. Bueno, uno postula, por ejemplo, hoy día y en 4 semanas o 6 semanas vas a recibir una carta de oferta. Pero solamente que si tú o que si Latino Australia Education sube los documentos que necesitas para que nosotros podemos ver que si tú cumples con los requisitos del programa. ¿Ya? La última fecha para poder postular al segundo semestre de 2016 es el 31 de mayo. Pero obviamente si estás pensando en postular para las becas del gobierno paraguayo, tendrías que postular antes de eso.
Ok, so, entonces sí, tenemos tiempo, pero tenemos que hacer un poco apurado, well, pensarlo rápido. Question from Silvana. What is the cost of living in Sydney to cover accommodation, transport and meals monthly?
Ooh, that's a very good question. That very much depends on your lifestyle. We suggest that a student lifestyle, you would be spending probably around $20,000 per year. Again, that varies very much depending on your lifestyle. If you go out and have, if you decide that you like to eat dinner out every night of the week, it's going to be far more expensive than if you stay home, share your food costs with your housemates, for example, and do your own cooking. In terms of transportation, look, the best option is to choose somewhere that's close by the university, probably within walking distance, or you might want to buy, for example, a bicycle. But yeah, I mean, it is hard to give an approximate cost, but we would say around $20,000 per year.
Okay, sí, yo puedo agregar algo de eso, Silvana. Bueno, en las becas, ellos están dando una mensualidad de $1,550 americanos. Yo he hecho una calculación ahí, es el equivalente de $26,000, $26,600 australianos por año. Y bueno, Thomas ha dicho que en vida de estudiante tiene que ser un presupuesto de $20,000 australiano. Entonces es bastante generoso y entonces por eso en las becas decía que no tiene el derecho para trabajar porque en esta plata puede vivir bastante bien. Otra pregunta de Lía, ¿cómo hago para postular a la beca del Estado paraguayo? Lía, nosotros estamos por supuesto un poco distinto al Estado paraguayo y las autoridades de las becas. Bueno, Thomas es la University of New South Wales y nosotros somos sus agentes en Paraguay. Nosotros podemos ayudar en todo los trámites de las aplicaciones, vuelos, todo, excepto, pero nosotros no podemos intervenir en las decisiones del Estado paraguayo para las becas. Esa es una decisión de ellos. Pero lo que nosotros tenemos entendido es que tiene que ir a ellos con el acceptance letter o certificate of enrollment para decir para acceptance letter en primero para decir que tú tienes un lugar en la universidad. Probablemente ellos van a pedir otro documentos, etcétera, pero y ahí todo eso información es en www.becal.gov.py. Nosotros hemos hablado mucho con ellos, tener reuniones con ellos, etcétera, y lo que he visto están muy muy abierto a cualquier duda de un estudiante. Y en este sitio web puede encontrar sus teléfonos. También ellos han dicho que están en la calle Estrella 345, dice que cualquier persona puede entrar a sus oficinas sin turno, sentar y hablar de cualquier cosa con ellos. Están muy, muy abiertos en eso. Entonces, están ahí también para ayudar a los estudiantes. Pero toda la parte de quién tiene la beca, quién no tiene la beca, no podemos intervenir nada. Pero tenemos una buena idea de qué son las áreas de estudios, qué son prioridades, qué son las edades, qué son los límites, qué son los prerequisitos de las universidades en rankings y todo. Sí, tenemos todo eso, pero el trámite tiene que ver solamente con ellos. Bueno, esa es la última pregunta que tengo en mi lista de aquí. Quiero decir gracias a Thomas por tomar el tiempo para hacer una presentación de tu universidad y realmente es una opción excelente para las becas. Es una de las mejores en el mundo y es importante para cuando toman las decisiones para las becas. Para la gente que no ha estado en el principio, para explicar, mi nombre es David Kingsbury, soy director de Latino Australia Education. Somos representantes de la University of New South Wales y en realidad todas las universidades. Nosotros estamos ahí para cualquier ayuda que necesitan en el asesoramiento, no solamente los cursos, para la vida en Australia y cualquier cosa. También hacemos las aplicaciones, también hacemos las visas, podemos organizar los vuelos y todo. Puedo decir que como trabajamos para las universidades, no cobramos nada a los estudiantes, es totalmente gratis para ustedes. Bueno, si no hay más preguntas, voy a decir buenas noches a todos ustedes, muchísimas gracias por la asistencia y estamos aquí para ayudar a ustedes. Gracias.